بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير خلق الله أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, our sustainer. And we ask Allah to send His peace and blessings upon His last prophet and messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his companions, upon his family, and upon those who choose to follow the prophetic guidance until the day of resurrection. Ameen, ameen. And we ask Allah to make us all from among them. We are still talking about the revealed wisdom. And we said that we mean by revealed wisdom, we mean by that some of the words of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, for indeed his words are part of the revelation. And our phrase that we're going to be shedding some light upon today is something which Umm Salama, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, tells us about. She says that كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِذَا أَصْبَحَ قَالَ اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أَسْأَلُكَ عِلْمًا نَافِعًا وَرِزْقًا طَيِّبًا وَعَمَلًا مُتَقَبَّلًا. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whenever it is morning time, he will say, O Allah, I ask you for عِلْمًا نَافِعًا. And the word عِلْمًا نَافِعًا means a beneficial knowledge, meaning something that will be beneficial for me, and at the same time it would be something that I could also help other people through. It is something beneficial. وَرِزْقًا طَيِّبًا, which means that I ask you for a halal provision, I ask you for a good provision. وَرِزْقًا طَيِّبًا وَعَمَلًا مُتَقَبَّلًا, and a good deed which is accepted by you. So this is a wonderful beginning for the day, a wonderful supplication, a wonderful prayer for every believing man and believing woman to start their day with. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam indeed used to say so many other supplications in the morning, meaning after Fajr prayer or so until Dhuhr time. And there are many other supplications that he would say at the evening time. And these prayers will make your day, inshallah ta'ala, full of blessings and full of joy and full of happiness. And they will help you through the difficult times that you might face during your days. And they will help you, inshallah ta'ala, also achieve the goodness of every day. And this is one of these supplications which contain so many meanings, and they will have a lot of, inshallah ta'ala, benefit for you if you say them. So let us reflect on these words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the beginning, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'a. So imagine yourself in the first hours of your day, of your morning, and you're praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this prayer. Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'a. O Allah, I ask you for knowledge which is beneficial. Now we know, my dear brothers and sisters, that there are many types of colleges that people could go to, many types of schools that people could go to, and so on and so forth, to learn about different things. But is everything that we're trying to learn or trying to read or trying to acquire would actually be very beneficial for us? As a matter of fact, no. We might end up reading a book which, may Allah Azza wa Jal protect us, but it might actually make the person go astray. Or a person might attend a lecture which gives him some kind of wrong information, and it will give him misconceptions rather than clearing some of the misconceptions that the person might have in his mind. So it is very important that in the morning, especially young people who are still going to schools and they're still exposed to teachers who will teach them in different disciplines and so on and so forth, to keep this prayer in mind. Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'a. O Allah, I ask you for a beneficial knowledge. And when they explain this beneficial knowledge or ilman nafi'a, they say that it is something which helps you, and at the same time it helps you help, inshallah ta'ala, other people. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the Holy Quran Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to ask for more of something. Now, what is that thing? Did Allah azza wa jalla say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ask Allah to give you more, for example, wealth or more money, more properties, more of this and more of that? Obviously, as a believer, you can ask Allah azza wa jalla for all of that. And again, it's a good deed if you ask Allah azza wa jalla even for dunya matters. But Allah azza wa jalla chose to teach His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a specific supplication when it came to asking for increase in something. And that thing is nothing but knowledge. Allah Azza wa Jal says in Surah Taha to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to the believers obviously who follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, follow the footsteps of the Prophet, and we ask Allah to make us from among them. In Surah Taha, Allah says, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا, and say, O my Lord, increase me in knowledge. O my Lord, increase me in knowledge. رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. So this is again another supplication, but the words of this supplication are from the Quran. And again, it befits every believing man and every believing woman to make this supplication part of the supplications which he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. O my Lord, increase me in knowledge. But why do we want to have more knowledge? Is it just because we want to have the mere information in our minds? Is it because we want to be able to show off? Is it because we want other people to look at us with awe and respect and so on and so forth? Or is there a greater aim? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws the attention of the believers for the greatest aim of knowledge. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, that indeed those people of knowledge are the people of khashya. And the word khashya means that they are the God-fearing ones. They are the God-conscious ones. So knowledge in Islam is something which will help you increase in your obedience to Allah. It is something which will make you know more about your Creator. It is something which will bring you closer to Allah. It is something which will open for you a path to paradise, and you want to acquire knowledge because you want to know all the things that might lead to the hellfire, and you want Allah Almighty to protect you from them. So there is a great place for knowledge in Islam. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as in Surah Muhammad, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ, know that there is no God but Allah, and استغفر لذنبك, seek Allah's forgiveness. And Imam al-Bukhari, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him and make him from the people of paradise, Imam al-Bukhari made a beautiful title in his book when he said, بَابٌ الْعِلْمُ قَبْلَ الْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ, meaning in this chapter we're going to discuss a hadith which proves that knowledge comes before al-amal, that knowledge comes before action. So you have to know the right thing and then you go ahead and do it. Otherwise, what you do will not be something that is acceptable. It's not going to be something correct. You have to know and then you act upon it. اعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله. Know that there is no God but Allah. واستغفر لذنبك, and seek your Lord's forgiveness. One of the greatest proofs that you actually have acquired good knowledge is applying that knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Holy Quran about a group of people who spend their nights in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they are standing up, they are bowing, they are prostrating to Allah azza wa jal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Holy Quran that after mentioning these kinds of people who are standing up all night and they're praying to Allah, prostrating, they're bowing and so forth, هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, are they equal, those who know and those who do not know? Obviously, they're not equal. So the experience itself, obviously, is part of knowledge, definitely. So you learn and then you implement, and your implementation will increase your knowledge. You learn that Allah is Sami'a, Allah is all-hearing, Allah is all-seeing, that Allah answers your prayers. Then you stand up at night and we ask Allah Almighty to make us from these people, and you ask Allah, knowing that He's all-hearing. You ask Allah, knowing that He's all-seeing. You turn to Allah and so forth, and this increases your knowledge. Inshallah, we have to take a small break, but then inshallah, we're going to continue with our thoughts and reflections upon this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hope you have the time to stay with us. Until then, I leave you with the peace and the blessings of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Blessing us with love. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His peace and blessings upon His last prophet and messenger Our prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam We're talking before the break about one of the ahadith of the prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam It's actually a supplication as Umm Salama, the wife of the prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam narrates She says that كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا أصبح قال She said whenever it is morning time the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would say اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا Or Allah I ask you for knowledge which is beneficial ورزقا طيبا And oh Allah I ask you for the good provision the halal provision وعملا متقبلا And a good deed which is accepted by you And this is a very beautiful supplication, as we said earlier, and it's such a wonderful beginning for a beautiful day that I hope that you will all always have beautiful mornings and beautiful days and evenings as well, afternoons, and before you go to sleep. The Prophet ﷺ said in this hadith, اللهم يسألك علما نافعا O Allah, I ask you for knowledge which is beneficial. And we talked earlier about the importance of having this beneficial knowledge and we said that there are many kinds of information that people might acquire in their days and in their nights and so forth and many of it might not be beneficial. So you ask Allah Azza wa Jal every day in the morning to make the knowledge that you learn something which is beneficial, something that will help you and inshallah ta'ala also it is something that by which you would be able to help other people. Now there are many virtues of knowledge. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about knowledge that it will lead you, inshallah, to become a God-fearing person. And this is one of the greatest aims of having knowledge, that you become from the people of God consciousness, you become from the people of khashiyan, you become from the people of taqwa, people who are God-fearing. And inshallah ta'ala, through this, you will increase your faith. ليعلم الذين أوتوا العلم أنه الحق من ربك فيؤمنوا به فتخبت له قلوبهم That the people of knowledge will know This is the first step That it is something from your Lord Okay فيؤمنوا به They believe in it فتخبت له قلوبهم And then their hearts will completely submit to Allah Will surrender And that this is the aim really of worship They become real worshippers of Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala Also Knowledge, when it comes to learning about the religion of Allah Azza wa Jalla and so forth, it is something which will increase and elevate your status. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتِ That Allah Azza wa Jalla increases the levels or elevates those among you who believe and those who have knowledge. It is also something which is a door for the continuation of good deeds after one dies. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمَ انْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ That if the human being dies, basically his deeds will be severed, meaning this line of continuation of good deeds, of reward and so forth is going to be severed because you are no longer praying, you are no longer fasting, you are no longer paying your charities, you can't go to Hajj, you can't recite the Qur'an. None of that is possible after the person dies. But there are certain good deeds which make this line of good deeds continue after the person dies. That his account, his balance of good deeds will keep increasing even though he's not doing anything. Now what are these good deeds? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ There are three things. صَدَقَةٍ جَارِيَةٍ Meaning a continuous charity. For example, you build the mosque, and after you build that mosque and people started coming to the masjid and so on and so forth, you're getting reward. And even if you die, that reward will, inshallah ta'ala, still continue and your good deeds will still be increasing. وَعِلْمٌ يُنْتَفَعُ بِهِ A beneficial knowledge, knowledge which other people will benefit from. وَوَلَدٌ صَالِحٌ يَدْعُو لَهُ A righteous son or daughter who will make dua for you. So I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to enable all of us to have all of these beautiful things in our lives. Allah Azza wa Jal, we ask Him to help us have some sort of a continuous charity. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to also help us leave some kind of a good inheritance of knowledge which other people will benefit from. And you could imagine, my dear brothers and sisters, let's suppose that you taught one of your kids just how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, the first surah of the Holy Quran, the first chapter of the Holy Quran. Now, every time your child recites that surah, then you are getting the same reward as your child. Now, imagine if you were a teacher and you taught 10 people, 50 people, 100 people the same surah. You're getting the same exact reward that they are getting every single time they pray. And they'll say this surah at least every time, 17 times every day. Now imagine when your students also teach other people the same surah. Can you imagine that? When you're also 100 students or so teach people the same surah, then they're getting their rewards and the rewards of the people whom they taught, and all of these people are also, you're getting from them the same reward as well. So leaving a legacy of knowledge is something very important and is something very virtuous in our religion, the religion of Islam. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to help us all have something like that. Then we're going to move to the second phrase, second supplication which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made. Allahumma as'aluka ilman nafi'a, O Allah, I ask you for beneficial knowledge. Then he says, wa rizqan tayyiba, and I ask you for a good provision, something which is halal. Now it is morning time, you're about to go to your job. This job could be something which is haram. It could be something by which the person, instead of gaining Allah's forgiveness, instead of helping other people learn something good, instead of helping humanity with something which will be beneficial for them, no, it could be something haram. It could be a person, for example, who is doing some kind of a riba job, some kind of usury or something like that. It could be that he's in an army that will, you know, kill other people or so, and so on and so forth. So the kind of provision that you earn, you always ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make it a good provision. You ask Allah Azza wa Jal to find something which is halal, and that is very important. And it was said that some of the pious women, before their husbands leave their houses, they will tell them, fear Allah, be God conscious in the way you're going to earn the money for today. And then she will tell them that we will be patient with some sort of poverty or so, but we cannot be patient when it comes to going to the hellfire. And that is obviously an advice of a very pious woman, that she knows that she needs to eat that which is halal and that her kids need to eat that which is halal. So she's reminding the man every day before he leaves the house that he has to make sure that his provisions are halal from halal means. One of the things that will help you have this halal provision is to turn to Allah Azza wa Jal every morning and to ask Him for this halal provision. وَرِزْقًا طَيِّبًا, O Allah, I ask you for this halal and good provision. And inshallah ta'ala, in a coming episode, we're going to talk in detail about some of the points, some of the good deeds that you could do to help you, inshallah ta'ala, achieve this halal provision and to also increase your provision. For example, Allah Azza wa Jal says, مَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Whoever has taqwa of Allah, is God conscious, then يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا, Allah will find you a way out. وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ, and Allah will provide for you from places that you've never imagined. For example, seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness, this is something which will open for you doors of provision as well. For example, having good relationships with your kinship and so forth. Again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam promises a person who does that Allah Azza wa Jal will open for them doors of provision, and that Allah Azza wa Jal will even extend their lifespans. Doing Umrah and doing Hajj, again, these are all things which will help all of us, inshallah, have, you know, a better provision, and that we will also, inshallah, be doing something which is pleasing to Allah Azza wa Jal, and that Allah Azza wa Jal will give us more barakah, more blessings in the rizq or the provisions that we're trying to get. Now the third phrase in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, اللهم يسألك علما نافعا, O Allah, I ask you for beneficial knowledge. ورزقاً طيبا, I ask you for a good provision. And وعملا متقبلا, and O Allah, I ask you for a good deed which will be accepted by you. And this is a very interesting dua, this last part of the supplication. وعملا متقبلا, and عمل, a good deed which will be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal. A good deed, and it's also accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because again, when you wake up in the morning and you do good things, for example, you try to get, for example, some good provision for your family. For example, you pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you make your du'as and your dhikr, you go and learn, and so on and so forth. You meet other people and you are nice to them and so on and so forth. All of these are good deeds, right? But try your best to also have a good intention when you do all of these things. For example, if a person goes to the salah, goes to the prayer, and he goes all the way to the masjid and coming back from the masjid, but he's doing that only because he wants other people to say, oh, this man must be a very pious person. He wants other people to praise him. He wants other people to think highly of him as a well-learned person, or, for example, a great worshipper, and so on and so forth. He will be, in that case, doing something for others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect us all from falling into that trap. It was said that the ulama of tafsir, the scholars who gave explanations to the Holy Quran, they differed among themselves which ayah in the Holy Quran would be the most scary ayah in the Quran. Which ayah in the Quran instills the most fear in people's hearts? And some of them will mention something about the hellfire, others will mention other forms of, you know, punishment that people will face on the Day of Judgment, and so on and so forth. But many of them say that it is the verse in Surah Al-Kahf in which Allah says, هَلْ أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا, should I inform you of those people who are going to be the losers on the Day of Judgment? Allah then says, الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا, those who went stray in this life, yet they think that they are doing great good deeds. They went stray, and in their minds they're thinking that they did great good deeds. And that is why it is very important to remember the two conditions for accepted good deed, and I'm sure all of you know that. And that is to do it solely for the sake of Allah, and to do it according to the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And let me give you one example and conclude with it. For example, in my country, in the Sudan, one of my teachers was telling us that he went to southern Sudan and he saw some of the missionaries. He said some of them, their colors turned into black, okay, because of the heat of the sun and so on and so forth. And he said, I couldn't really know the color of his skin until he moved the belt from his bag. And he said, look at these kind of people. They're working so hard, but it is not in the right track. It's not something which will take people to paradise and protect them from the hellfire. Rather, it is something that will take people to the hellfire and will prevent them from Jannah. So it's very important to ask Allah to help you do a good deed, but it is also something which is acceptable by Allah. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal at the end to give us the beneficial knowledge, to give us the good provision, and to help us do the good deeds that will be accepted by Him. Ameen, ameen. And until I see you again, inshallah, I leave you with the peace and the blessings of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.